My name is Gein van Toledo. I'm a PhD candidate at the Utrecht University. I'm also part-time civil servant for the national government of the Netherlands. And today my colleagues are not here, unfortunately, but I'm presenting this research. And I'm presenting our research evaluating Dutch named entity recognition identification methods in the human research domain. So the next, So the next half hour, I will introduce text de-identification in the human research domain. I will elaborate something about the background in this research. I will explain the methods. We did a lot of different kind of evaluations, and I will explain also our used data set. Then we go to the results, and yes, there are three kinds of results. And then there's some discussion and conclusions yet, and I use some references in my slides, so I also have that in the in this presentation, and then some questions can be asked. So first, the introduction. The text de-identification in human research. We use text de-identification for preparing a data set for further research. Human research contains a lot of privacy sensitive information. Think about performance appraisals, documenting reports, but also job applications, curriculum vitae's, and we got a lot of emails with work-related questions about sickness, advance payments, vacations, maternity and paternity leave, related declarations, and so forth and so forth. And we see and we notice that there is a lot of involvement of works councils and employees. So when you're doing research, you have to do it with a well-prepared data set. Otherwise, our colleagues or other employees are raising questions and raising protests against the research. So text de-identification in the human research domain is from the bottom up a very important subject, but we go also from the top, also regulations, and last, I think 2 years ago, the General Data Protection Regulation came into the European Union, and also for the Netherlands. And that also gives a lot of burdens for doing research in the human research domain. We see that there is a lot of text de-identification research in the medical domain, but not in the human research domain. So we transfer the text de-identification from the medical domain to the human research domain. And our question in this research is, to which extent can current de-identification methods anonymize Dutch human research related texts? So first, the background, and I'm going to tell what's already done for Dutch named entity recognition. And we see that there are two ways to do named entity recognition. And it's rule-based or statistical. And named entity recognition is needed for detecting names, but also dates, organization locations, and all kind of information in what text documents contain. For the Dutch language, there are two public data sets for statistical named entity recognition learning. The first is the Connell 2002, and the second is SONAR 1. Connell 2002 is based on Niels items, while the SONAR 1 is based on Niels, but also on foreign text documents or chats or something like that. So we expect in our research that zone one must be doing a much better job for recognizing entities in text. So that's one. Second, there's also software in this area. The first is Vrock, and in for the Dutch language. And Vrock is based on Sonar 1, and it's made like 10 years ago. There's also Polyglot. It's created, I think, a couple of years ago. And in this domain, we see also the rise of the BERT models. And those language models, which BERT is, enhances statistical named entity recognition to a much better level. So this is the first background giving. Second is about Dutch de-identification methods. There are now two kinds of de-identification methods, and they both originate from the medical domain. Both are also created for psychiatry. The first is DDUS, and it's created here at Utrecht University, and it's a simple rule-based text de-identification method. You give the method a lot of organizational data, and organizational data is important for recognizing names, because an organization could deals with a lot of persons, and when you store that, you can use that for de-identification. But you got also the method of Jung Kim Sung, TKS. Unfortunately, the author didn't give any name to this method. So we call it TKS in this paper. And it's based on both statistical named entity recognition with rule-based text de-identification. It works also with organizational data, but first in this method you have to use a named entity recognition model. In this case, it was based on Vrock, but you can also add add other named entity recognition models. Then the policy. So what is a personal identifiable element? The GDPR is very broad in this sense, and it says any information relating to an identified or identifiable natural person. Well, the HIPAA, not applicable in the Netherlands or anywhere in the European Union, provides 17 elements like names, medical record numbers, account numbers, telephone and fax numbers, websites, emails, all kinds of elements. So that gives already some sense of what's identifiable and what's not. And we see that in the policies also, when you de-identificate a text document, it still requires some sort of management. So you can't freely give the data set to the public because, in the case of the Netflix, in Netflix, it provides a public data set based on persons, and they could reveal the persons in those data sets. So it requires a lot of management still. Next, we go to the methods. And we did some named entity recognition construction, and we do also evaluation. We took two kind of BERT language models. First is BERT multilingual, and the second is BERT, it's the Dutch BERT. And it's based on only Dutch texts. So it's only given Dutch texts, and multilingual is also based on other languages. And therefore, you use the two data sets, the Connell 2002 and the Sonar 1. And we also used for evaluation Polyglot and Frog. Well, the test metrics, I assume you know how they work. So I don't give any kind of formula. You can look it up on Wikipedia or whatever you find on Google. But I have to tell something. We find the recall the most important one because our task is to suppress identifiable elements in text. So the recall gives a metric that that you suppress all kind of elements in the text. Then we find the F1 score, second important metric, because the F1 score takes the recall into account, but also the precision. And the precision comes last in this research because you can, in our opinion, you can better de-identificate too much than to few names or identifiable elements in text. Second evaluation is de-identification method evaluation. And like the previous one, we constructed the entity recognition models. We used also a Polyglot Frog. And there are two kinds of evaluations in this part. And the first one is the strict evaluation, and that's what I already strict evaluation part. And that the task in this evaluation is that it must suppress the element in the text, like a name or date, and must label it right. So when you get a location and it is suppressed with a location and suppressed with a personal name, that is not considered as a good one. And second is the loose sense evaluation. And in this one, a personal identifying element must be suppressed somehow. So it doesn't matter what kind of label it got, as long it is suppressed. And in this kind of evaluation, only the recall counts and not the F1 score or precision. So our data set, our data set is originate from more than 300,000 email correspondences, and we picked from those 300,000 2,070 emails, and we annotated by ourselves, and we moved before that the signatures, and we also removed the HTML in those emails. There's a mean of 6.69 annotation per email correspondence, with a standard deviation of 11.2 annotations. So there's some variety in this correspondences. There's also a second radar, and this second radar evaluate my annotation, and it did that with annotating by himself, annotating 283 email correspondences. It's a 40% sample. And we came to an annotator agreement with a kappa score of 0.92. And that's sufficient that what I annotated is also, in his opinion, a good identifiable element. We see in this data set that dates are a lot of available, numbers, and third, the person. But we see also a lot of gender reveal parts in this data set, like him or her, but also Mr. and Mrs. and kind of elements. You see a lot of times the organization be named in the data set, because we have a data set based on all kinds of organizations in the Netherlands. Emails, we saw a lot of emails, locations, job titles, for example, PhD candidate in my part, or advisor to the board, something like that. We saw also codes, and codes can be IBAN numbers for your bank account. We see also other kind of codes identifying a person. We see titles like PhD, doctor, but also Duke, kind of stuff. And we see also websites, and those websites are revealing the person's organization where he or she is working. So how do this correspondence look like? So we see two examples, and we see a lot of identifying role elements. We see here, for example, the 9th of October, I am seconded to the Apeldoorn office of the Tax and Customs Administration. And in this one, you see a organization location, BI Amsterdam, also all kinds of identifiable elements. You see the name John, a number, emails, and so forth. So now we go to the results. And the first one is the named entity recognition evaluation. And it's based on three kind of elements. Sona got two more. It's products and events. And there's also another one, the miscellaneous. And this one, for us, is too vague to use it in human resource texts. And we see that the Connell dataset is performing best regarding the recall. And that's something we didn't expect, because the Connell database is based on only news items and not on all kinds of other various text documents. And we didn't expect, we expect that the sonar was performing much better. But we see that the BERT models are performing much better than the old Polyglot and the FRAC recognition. Second is the strict de-identification. And we added the date and the number. Dedus, unfortunately, didn't use any right tools for numbers, only telephones, telephone numbers, and birthdays. So we didn't apply the number metric for Dedus. But we see again that the TKS is performing in almost every sense better than the old Frog and the Dedus. For example, the recall is 0.92. Also 0.68 for recall. And we see that the dates are suppressed very well in the Connell Bertje. DKS also got sometimes a lower precision and recall than the named entity recognition, and that's because when your organizational data is telling something else, then DGS have the behavior that it follows follows the organizational data, not the name entity recognition model. So that's the behavior we saw in this kind of software. Yeah, so that's the strict the identification part. Then the loose sense de-identification, and we see more metrics. I have to get the screen a little bit back. Yeah. So the loose sense de-identification, and it only got the recall, and we see a higher part, the highest part in Conal Bertje. Location is very well suppressed. But we see when we look at these human research elements like job titles, gender, email, it's very low. Also codes, it does a good way work with numbers, but we see still a lot of, it's 0.60 and it's not sufficient in the human research domain. Also a very low score on websites, emails, did a worse job on emails, and that's what the way some emails are written. We came a lot of emails with a space bar between it, and we don't know how it, why people are doing that, but sometimes there's a space bar in the email. It's not correct, but people make noisy text, we saw. The gender indeed is very high, and that's because it can identify parts like Mr. and Mrs. or titles like PhD, Duke, Doctor, and so forth. Master of Science also. So in our opinion, these two methods, DDoS and DGS, have to combine and give a much better base for text de-identification in the human research domain. So the discussion in this this research is, text documents are very noisy, we notice, and people are writing their names very strange. For example, your name with a lower written in lowercase, and those named entity recognition models cannot handle the lower names. And also, organizational data depends on higher cased names. We see also that text de-identification is, in none of the cases, an automated job. We see that still 8% or 6% sometimes the names are not suppressed, and human eyes are still needed. But we see, in this kind of research, that rule-based is never sufficient, but also named entity recognition is also not sufficient. So there's two kind of methods are needed in text de-identification in our domain. And BERT, the new language models and all kinds of other versions, gives a boost to the traditional named entity recognition methods. So to our conclusion, to which extent can current de-identification methods anonymize Dutch human research related text? We see that none of the methods could certify all personal identifying elements. But we see that in some areas, the methods are performing very well. For example, in person names, and that's still the most important one. But still, you want to identify as much as possible because the law and the employees are both asking for this job. These are some references, and Are there any questions? Thank you for listening.